So Tesla apparently has plans to start to produce their own battery cells in order to significantly increase their battery producing capacity within the next years and to also get more independent from Panasonic.
Then we also got some updates on the progress of the Gigafactory 3 in Shanghai. We also got some news about the Lightyear One, a super efficient and quite interesting car that was recently unveiled. And then we also got some news on boring tunnels, flying cars, and even the Hyperloop. You know, the usual stuff.
These news and more on this week's episode of, well, not quite electric car news anymore, but more like futuristic transportation news.
So we have already heard that Tesla is not quite satisfied with the battery capacity output of Panasonic, effectively bottlenecking the production of cars they can produce every year. So instead of producing 34 gigawatt hours per year, Panasonic is only producing 25 gigawatt hours per year currently, which effectively resulted in the postponing of the Tesla semi-truck because there simply isn't enough battery capacity output to bring it to market before late 2020. The Model S, 3 and X alone will probably account for maybe up to 400,000 sold vehicles in 2019. But the Model Y isn't even launched yet and it's estimated to sell better than the Model 3. And then to top it off, the Cyberpunk pickup truck will also launch sometime in 2020. And then also the new Tesla Roadster. That's why the Tesla semi-truck had to be unfortunately postponed, because in order to deliver this giant new lineup of vehicles, which Tesla will bring to the market, Tesla must expand its battery capacity.
So rumors have surfaced that Tesla is researching their own ways of producing battery cells. It was not specifically mentioned if and how Maxwell Technologies' dry electrode fabrication process or supercapacitors will be included. But we assume that Tesla will certainly be working hard to incorporate these technologies into their newest battery cells. That would lead to an impressive increase in the lithium-ion energy density. We will certainly learn more on the Battery and Powertrain Day that is scheduled for later this year, where Elon Musk himself will reveal some new interesting details about Tesla's upcoming battery plans. In other news, the Gigafactory 3 is now finished on the outside. We can see that the installation of production equipment is already in full swing, and Tesla is recruiting technicians for the beginning of production later this year.
And as if that wasn't enough, we also learned that the Chinese government wants to support Tesla by building a Tesla Parts Industrial Park. Now that facility would basically supply Tesla with all needed parts, drastically increasing the efficiency of Tesla's supply chain and therefore making Gigafactory 3's production much more effective and flexible. A level of flexibility that is in fact even higher than in the US. We find it somehow funny that Tesla seems to be getting more support from the Chinese government than from the US government. While in the US, big oil, the old legacy car makers, and big hedge funds try their very best to destroy Tesla, China instead is embracing Tesla because they full well know the potential of Tesla for the future of electric mobility. Even now, the highest amount of electric vehicles is already sold in China, and estimates show that 7 million electric vehicles will be sold annually in China by 2025.
The US should do everything in their power to support Tesla, because if America won't, then China certainly will. Then, the Lightyear One has recently been unveiled, and it's a pretty interesting electric car, we have to say. What makes it so interesting is that it's covered with a lot of solar cells, giving it up to 70 kilometers of range for each day that the car is left outside standing in the sun. The total range will be up to 750 kilometers or 450 miles. And the focus here is efficiency and not performance. So don't expect Tesla-type acceleration and top speed figures.
And you can officially reserve one right now for the very nice sum of only 149,000 euros. Well, that sounds like an, let's put it like this, interesting pricing strategy. It's slated to launch in 2021, but actually we're not sure if worldwide or in Europe because it's a Dutch company and we suspect it will be first only launched in Europe. Anyway, even with this quite insanely high price, we're still pretty amazed to see new electric car makers and electric car startups come to market with new amazing vehicles, because more competition in the end is good for the consumer, and more electric cars will basically only accelerate the death of the internal combustion engine, which is a very good thing.
And then, to the shock of many diehard petrol heads, first Daimler, now even BMW, is reporting a reduced earnings and sales estimate for 2019. Back in April, Daimler said that their financial targets have become harder to achieve after a tough start to the year. Q1 profits were down 16% compared to Q4 2018. Weird that there was no outcry on that, as compared to the lower Tesla Q1 2019 sales, where everyone just went into full-scale panic mode.
And now BMW is also starting to show more severe signs of trouble, casting doubt on the continuation of Harald Krüger, that is Krüger with an Ü, you know, Ü, not Krüger, but Ü Krüger, as CEO in 2020. And there are rumors that the advisory board of BMW is actually seeking to maybe replace him by 2020 with a CEO that is more aggressive on electric vehicles.
Under Krüger as CEO, BMW has totally lost their competitive head start, which they had with the i3. And stupid statements, like the one from the BMW Group board member for development, Klaus Fröhlich, that's Ö, not O, who recently stated that, quote, "electrification is overhyped. These engines have at least 20 more years. Don't help to make BMW's image better." Well, ladies and gentlemen, these are the signs of the dying ICE car. We are pretty sure that quite a few legacy car makers won't survive the epic transition to electric cars in the upcoming years. Then, finally some talk on the Boring Company tunnels. Recently, we could see a Model 3 shoot through the Hawthorne Boring Company test tunnel at a nice speed of 116 miles per hour. And apparently, the Las Vegas Boring Company tunnel is a done deal now, slated to be fully finished and operational just in time for the CES 2021.
And it will shoot people from station to station at the Las Vegas Convention Center with speeds of up to 150 miles per hour. The Las Vegas system is slated to transport at least 4,400 people per hour between the center's new exhibit and South Halls, which would be a 20-minute walk by foot. So things are really progressing on the Boring Company front. Now, contrary to Elon Musk on this channel, we are huge fans of flying cars. And we think that flying cars or flying air taxis or flying drones, call them whatever you will, need to exist at the same time in addition to the Boring Company tunnels. The more modes of transportation we have, the better, in order to reduce traffic jams and traffic congestion. And actually, there will be an amazing synergy between three different modes of transportation. Boring Company tunnels below the ground, self-driving cars on the street level, and flying cars in the air. And this synergy will make traffic jams and traffic congestion a thing of the past. We previously already talked about some upcoming air taxis, like for example the German-based company Lilium from Munich here, of which we talked a lot in one of our last videos, which you can watch right here. And now news emerged that Boeing and Kitty Hawk will partner on flying air taxis.
Kitty Hawk is a flying car company backed by Google's Larry Page. Its vertical taking off and landing electric air taxi Cora will be able to seat two persons and have a range of 62 miles or 100 kilometers. Not bad. And now some news for the coolest mode of long distance transportation, the famous Hyperloop. It actually is progressing. In particular, the proposed Chicago-Cleveland Hyperloop track by Hyperloop Transportation Technologies got some backing in Congress. Lawmakers in the US House of Representatives gave the US Department of Transportation $5 million to create environmental and safety standards for all proposed Hyperloops and to find regulatory holes. However, the bill must still be approved by the US Senate before reaching the president's desk. Nonetheless, seeing US lawmakers seriously contemplating the Hyperloop in the US is a good sign. Hopefully high-speed rail is completely bypassed, and we will see the Hyperloop become the long-distance travel mode of choice connecting all US major cities in the future. Of course, the aviation and railroad lobby won't be amused and will try to prevent that.
However, history has shown that new innovative modes of transportation always tend to win in the end. And while in the US they still talk and talk and talk, in India, Virgin Hyperloop One is actually preparing a 15-kilometer test track. The 15-kilometer test track is proposed to be constructed between, I have no idea how it's pronounced, but something like Kivale and Urze on Mumbai Pune Expressway. Well, if this test track is successful, a full-length test track between those two big cities is planned to be built, which would be 148 kilometers long. It would basically reduce the travel time between those big two Indian cities from many hours to only 13 minutes. Well, we certainly will keep you updated on the fascinating development that is the Hyperloop.
So do you believe that the Hyperloop will be really built soon, or it's just a pipe dream?
And do you agree with our view that flying air taxis will be needed in addition to the boring company tunnels?
And as always, we would be very happy if you subscribe to our channel and share this video with your friends.
Don't let yourself be distracted by me.
And turn on that notification bell, of course.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
So see you next time.
Ciao.